My name is Lee Fletcher. I'm a planetary scientist here at the University of Leicester, and I've been part of the JUICE mission since around about 2008 when it was first being formulated. Today, I serve as one of three interdisciplinary scientists on the JUICE mission, overall tasked with trying to manage the Jupiter atmospheric science that we're going to be doing from this spacecraft in the 2030s. What we are trying to do as interdisciplinary scientists is make sure that the spacecraft, as it's designed, as it's built, and as ultimately it's operated around Jupiter, is going to achieve all of the scientific goals that we first set out for it back in 2010, 2011 or so. So it's keeping sight of the overarching picture of this mission, whilst also making sure that it's dealing with the nitty-gritty details of some of the operations that it's going to do. I study how Jupiter's atmosphere shifts and evolves and changes over long spans of time. And I do that via remote sensing. So what I want to do is have instrumentation that spans the electromagnetic spectrum all the way from the ultraviolet out to the microwave, because all of those different wavelength ranges, they tell you something different about the atmosphere of Jupiter. If you think of Jupiter's atmosphere like an onion with various different layers of an onion, the different wavelengths sample different layers. That's no good doing one wavelength in isolation, because you'll only learn about one layer. So what JUICE is aiming to do is use as many wavelengths as possible across the electromagnetic spectrum to sound all the way from the high atmosphere, where the auroras dance and interact with the ionosphere, down through the stratosphere, into the troposphere, and the troposphere is where you get all those tremendous colourful clouds and stripes and storms and vortices being formed. So we want to see how energy flows from the bottom of the atmosphere to the top and vice versa, to teach us about Jupiter's atmosphere as a sort of archetype, not just for giant planets here in our solar system, but for also giant planets around other stars as well.
My name is Cecilia Tubiana. I'm a scientist working at IAPS in Rome, and I'm working on the JANUS camera, and I'm the operation manager and ground segment responsible for the JANUS camera. It's the instrument that will take the images, that will show us really what JUICE will see when it arrives at the Jovian system. And actually, it will show us also what JUICE will see in its way towards the Jovian system, because we really have some hopes that we will be able to operate the camera also, for instance, during the planetary swing bys, or even if it's possible when crossing the main belt, and so observe some asteroid, a bit as other missions have done. For instance, Rosetta did this in its way to 67 Pichurium of Gerasimenko. It had two flybys of two asteroids, because also scientifically it is really relevant and important to have high resolution images of many solar system objects. JANUS is a visible camera, and it's equipped with 13 filters. It has one panchromatic filter, so very, very broad band, and then a few filters which are, let's say, medium bandpass, and a few others which have a very small bandpass, which are mainly sought to look at gas signatures. And so the medium bandpass filters are the ones which will be used mainly to characterize the surface of the moons of Jupiter, because they are so the typical blue, red, green and filters, which are the ones which are used to in the end build the RGB's images, which are the ones which allows us also, for instance, to obtain the slopes, these spectral slopes, which are linked with the physical properties of the surface of these objects.
I'm Randy Gladstone. I'm the principal investigator of the ultraviolet spectrograph on the JUICE mission. And we've prepared the instrument as under funding from NASA to contribute to the JUICE mission, which is an ESA project, and we're very happy to be on board. Turns out that most matter interacts in some way with photons, and atoms and molecules are very good at interacting with photons in the ultraviolet wavelengths. So they're more energetic than the visible light we see. We see a tiny fraction of the entire electromagnetic spectrum, of course, and there's infrared and radio at longer wavelengths. And at shorter wavelengths, the next thing down is ultraviolet before you get to X-rays. And it turns out matter interacts really strongly with those wavelengths of photons, because that's generally the energy difference between electronic levels in atoms and molecules. So the atoms have a very strong interaction when that energy difference between their levels matches a photon energy, and then they can, you know, interact with one another. It makes that region of wavelengths very useful for remote sensing what a region of space has in it, the molecules and atoms in it. And in the UV, we can see very tenuous amounts of matter. So very wispy gas amounts or, you know, thin atmospheres, basically, from a long distance away. So on JUICE, that's very useful because a lot of the Galilean satellites have very tiny atmospheres, but we can sense them and determine what they're made of, what composition of the molecules and atoms in their atmosphere with our instrument. So we have different ways of doing that. We also look at the reflected light. The sunlight's always shining on these guys, and we look at the light bouncing off the surface, and that again tells us about what the surface is made of and what the structure of the surface is.
My name is Emma Bunce, and I'm a planetary scientist at the University of Leicester in the UK. My role on JUICE is that I'm working with the magnetometer team, JMAG, and with the ultraviolet spectrometer team, UVS. Jupiter's aurora is the brightest aurora in the solar system, no surprise there. It's got the strongest magnetic field. It's the planet of superlatives. Ganymede's magnetic field, we don't have a huge amount of information about. And the aurora at Ganymede is much weaker. Ganymede's atmosphere is much more tenuous, but it's an oxygen atmosphere and produces a relatively weak few tens of Rayleighs of auroral emission in Ganymede's atmosphere. But you can see that emission is banded in the north and the south, looking a little bit like auroral ovals that we see elsewhere in the solar system. Interestingly, the auroral ovals observations from Hubble Space Telescope can actually tell us a little bit about whether we think the ocean is present or not. So it's rather complex to explain, but fundamentally there's a tilt in those ovals north and south, and you can estimate using modelling of the electromagnetic coupling what the tilt should be, either with a conducting ocean or without, for that changing Jupiter magnetic field moving back and forth across Ganymede. And some interesting work done by Joachim Sauer has shown that the results from the Hubble Space Telescope are very much in line with there being a global ocean in the subsurface. So that's a really nice and again tantalizing piece of evidence, piece of the puzzle before we get there with JUICE.
We can actually do interior science too. So it sounds strange, but a lot of our science comes from watching stars that are bright in the UV pass behind a body like the Europa or Ganymedes. And that way we can sense the atmosphere. But it turns out that we can time those events so to the millisecond, so that gives us, when we measure when it goes behind the body, it gives the solid body people that are interested in tides and stuff flexing the crust, it gives them a measurement of the height of that surface to a few meters. So they're very excited by what we can do for them too.
My name is François Poulet. I'm an astronomer at the Institut d'Astrophysique Spatiale, which is a space research institute in the south of Paris at Orsay. And for the JUICE mission, I am the PI of the MAJIS instrument, which is a moons on Jupiter imaging spectrometer. MAJIS will investigate the composition of the surface of the satellite. So we will try to map actually the different species, such as salt, such as water ice, such as organics, if we detect organics. And then to look at the correlation with some spatial structure, which should be constrained by the JANUS instrument. We would like also to study the composition of the Jupiter atmosphere. We would like to monitor the aurora and to look at the relationship with the Io Taurus. We also foreseen to observe the Io volcanic activity and also to characterize the rings of Jupiter.
Maybe it's okay. My name is Giuseppe Piccioni, and I am Director of Research here at the Institute, which is the Institute of Astrophysics and Planetology. And my involvement is especially for MAJIS, being a co-principal investigator together with the French colleagues with the imaging spectrometer on board of JUICE. This is very important stuff. In fact, there are spectrometers, but laboratory spectrometers, not something that can really fly. This is big stuff. And this spectrometer is an infrared spectrometer. It's connected to this special gas cell, which is able to reproduce as much as possible the atmospheric conditions of gases, in particular for hydrogen and helium, which is the main components of the atmosphere of Jupiter. And so here we measure the opacity, so how the gases can consider it, let's say, transparent for the light, so that we can use this data and together with the model to correlate the data that we are getting from, in particular, from the Jupiter atmosphere.
I'm Paul Hartach from the Max Planck Institute for Solar System Research in Göttingen, in Germany. And we are testing here the sub-millimeter wave instrument telescope and receiver unit. It measures basically atmospheres and surfaces. The specific feature of this instrument is it has an extremely high spectral resolution, and therefore we can resolve all kinds of finest features of molecular lines in atmospheres. We have on the one hand molecular lines in the atmosphere of Jupiter, on the other hand molecular lines in the very thin atmospheres of the Galilean satellite. Finally, we also can observe the surfaces of the moons and two polarizations and two wavelength ranges from which we learn about the electrical and thermophysical properties. And that tells us something, for instance, the composition of the ices. Maybe there are some salts in it, maybe we can see that. Or also bubbles, and what is the mixture of ice and the regolith, things like that.
My name is Miriam Rengel. I am a scientist and astronomer working for use for the project in two different boards. In one part, I am co-investigator of SWI for use. And on the other board, I am also in the instrumental board and the documentation and control configuration head.
Set, sys, thank
God. We are living in golden times where we have the capacity to build instrumentations and missions where dreams just some years ago. And now we have this capacity, but this is not the end. This is just a journey. And this is a step. After this step, the journey will continue.